what their portion of revelation is as it relates to this dimension. And so I'm anxious to hear what God wants to say to us. So our first person coming up is Apostle Frank Chapman, one of my spiritual sons from Charlotte, North Carolina. Amen.
Amen.
Tremendous preacher, teacher, revelator in the Word. And so we have half an hour sessions. We want to hear what God's going to say to us. So come on, man of God, and let the Lord use you. Apostle Frank Chapman.
We worship you. We honor you in this place. We thank you for this place and this time, for this portion that you have given us. We're so thankful. You're worthy of all the praise. Come on, open your mouth and worship him. Hallelujah. Thank and praise him and glorify him. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for this building, for this man of God. These are people that are gathered here. We're so honored and grateful and thankful.
Thank you.
Thank you, Jesus.
Yes.
Thank you, Lord. Just go around the room and tell the person around you, tell them, I'm glad to see you. I'm glad you're here. Glad you're here. You tell them God has something for you today at this place. God has something for you today. God has something for you today in this place. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Give honor to God, to Chief Apostle Prude and all the apostles and prophets and all of God's people that are in this place. It's an honor and privilege to be here. I thank the Lord for all of his blessings and everything he's done for us, all of his anointing, for his power. And I on my way here, I was thinking about ministering, and I didn't think I was going to have the opportunity, but Lord impressed in my heart, if I had the opportunity to share this word, something God has been dealing with me about, I guess, for about a month, and this is the word of God to you, to encourage you, and you can take it like this is God speaking directly to me. God is speaking directly to me, to my situation, to what I'm dealing with. God is speaking directly to you. In Colossians chapter number 4, starting at verse number 2. We're going to jump around a few scriptures. Apostle said I had about a half an hour, and I'm quite sure it's not the half an hour that Prophetess Capehart had last night. I'm sure it's
29 minutes.
Now, he told me, now I'm at 29 minutes. Colossians chapter number 4. Chapter number 4, starting at verse number 2. And what God is saying that, or what we're asking from the Lord is, Father, show us the open door. Show us the open door. And the apostle basically hinted on some of it yesterday when he was talking. But Colossians chapter number 4, verse 2, continue in prayer and watch in the same with thanksgiving, with all praying also for us that God would open unto us a door of utterance to speak the mystery of Christ, for which I am also in bonds. So the Apostle Paul is telling the church at Colossae to pray for us that a door, a open door, would be open, open door for utterance to speak the mysteries of Christ. Now, he had a lot of needs. He had a lot of needs, being in prison and some of the things the Apostle Paul dealt with. He had a lot of needs, but he did not focus on his needs. He did not tell them to pray for me, pray, you know, that I get out of prison, pray that God touch me. You know, the prisons of that day were very, very bad. It wasn't like today, but prisons of that day, you didn't eat unless somebody brought you some food. You could be in dungeon. Men and women were together. It was a lot of rape that went on, molestation that went on, and you could be in a prison. You could be up to your ankles, ankle deep in feces. That's how bad it was. Paul didn't pray, don't pray that I get out of that. Pray that a door might be opened to utter the mysteries of Christ. That's what I want you to pray for. So he's talking about a open door. He says, continue. This is an ancient Greek word from the root, which means, continue means to be strong. It implies perseverance and fervor. It brings dominion. To continue brings dominion. To continue in prayer brings dominion. It is a to have fervor, to be persistent, to be insistent, to be resolute, to go on and not stop, to continue in prayer, to be earnest in prayer for this door to open, to be earnest in prayer. Earnestness implies it is the kind of prayer that is important. It does not come easy. To be earnest, to continue in prayer, it does not come easy against all of the opposition, all of the pitfalls of life, to be earnest in prayer. Earnest in prayer speaks of great effort, steadily applied, great effort, steadily applied, to be earnest in prayer, to continue in prayer. That's what he prayed. The Apostle Paul talked about an open door constantly throughout the scriptures in Acts 14 and 27. He said, and when they were come, they and had gathered the church together, they rehearsed all that God had done with them and how he had opened the door of faith unto the Gentiles. This word open means, the Greek meaning means a vestibule, a gateway. That he's opening a gateway, a vestibule, a channel. He's praying, God, open a gateway so I can minister. Open a channel. Open a vestibule. Open these things unto me. In 1 Corinthians 16 and 9, he says, for a great door of effectual is open unto me, that there are many adversaries. So in spite of the adversaries, a gateway has been opened unto me. In spite of the adversaries, a channel has been opened unto me. This is what the Apostle Paul is saying in Ephesians 6, 18 and 19. He says, praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, and watching thereunto with all perseverance and supplication for all saints and for me, that utterance may be given unto me, that I may open my mouth boldly to make known the mystery of the gospel. So here he's praying constantly in the scripture, God, open a channel, open a gateway. How many need a channel open for them? How many, I mean, for your ministry, you need a gateway open for you. You need something open. You need something unlocked. And you don't really know how to get it. There are things in our ministry, in our lives, that are locked up. How many got things we want God to do? We want God to do, and they haven't been opened yet. So here, this is what Paul is praying. God, open these channels, these gateways. Open these things unto me that I might minister the gospel. A lot of us are not even thinking about our own personal needs. We're trying to complete the kingdom of God. Cause the kingdom of God to be flourish in our lives, not only in our lives, but in the lives of our members and those that are connected with us. to allow the kingdom, basileia, God's dominion, his reign in our lives, his authority in our lives. So this is what the Apostle Paul is praying for, that the kingdom of God might be wrought in my life, and that the mysteries of God, that the great word of God, that the gospel might go forth in me. Let nothing hold me back, but I need an open door. Look at somebody and say, I need an open door. I need something broken. I need something open for me. I need a channel to go through. I need a vestibule to go through. I need these things open unto me. So let's turn to Acts chapter number 16. Apostle Paul is praying about a vestibule being open. This is the word he was talking about, but the word is going to change a little bit here in Acts. Acts chapter number 7. Chapter number, verse number 6, Acts 16, verse number 6. Now, the Apostle Paul had ministered throughout the whole known world. In chapter number 16, chapter 15 and 16, he starts his second missionary journey around the world. Now, his first missionary journey started in Acts chapter number 13, and this is a little sidebar. They laid hands, the Bible says in chapter number 13, verse 1, they laid hands on the Apostle Paul and they prayed for him. Verses 1 through 4, they laid hands on him and they prayed, they fasted, and they laid hands on him and they sent him out. Now, it mentions two names, Simon of Cyrene and Lucius. It mentions these are black men, Simon of Niger and Lucius of Cyrene. Black men laid hands on the Apostle Paul on his first missionary journey. Wow, wow, wow. Now, they don't tell us that everywhere else, but the Bible, for some reason, put these black men's name that laid hands on the Apostle Paul for his first missionary journey. Wow. Now, here in chapter number 16, he's starting his second missionary journey. He's going out again, and he's starting his second missionary journey, and he's trying to get into Asia, the continent of Asia, Macedonia. He's trying to get in there, and in verse 6, it says, in chapter 16, it says that the Holy Ghost forbid him to go there and preach the gospel. It forbid him. Then he goes down a little further in Messiah and some of the other cities, and it says that it suffered him not to go in to preach the gospel. It suffered him and forbid him. Now, this is why we're here. We're all here because we're ministers, apostles of the gospels, prophets, prophetess, evangelists, teachers, pastors. We're here to minister. That's why we came, to get a greater understanding, a greater revelation of what God has called me to do. He's called me into his kingdom to further the kingdom of God, his basileia, his authority, his kingdom in the earth. And he's did all of that, and seems like there are some struggles I'm going through trying to do this. There are some things blocked. There are some doors that will not open. There are some hindrances to stop me from doing what God told me to do. And I've got all kinds of words. I've got all kinds of words. What he's going to do through my ministry. What he's going to do through my life. How he's going to use me. But for some reason, the door is not open. The door is closed for some reason. And here the Apostle Paul is going into Macedonia. That's why God called him. He knocked him off his animal and put him, caused him to be blind and saved him and brought him out, and that was his purpose, to preach the gospel to the Gentiles. And all of a sudden, it's blocked. To get in is blocked. So it says that it doesn't even say that he prayed. I know he prayed. He continued in prayer. Like I said, prayer is a continuation. It is a steady thing applied that I keep going on. I'm earnest in prayer. I will not stop. I will not give up until God gives me what he said he was going to give me. So he prays, and while he's praying, verse 9 says, and a vision appeared to Paul in the night. There stood a man in that Macedonia and prayed, saying, come into Macedonia and pray for us. And after that he had seen the vision, immediately endeavored to go into Macedonia, assuredly gathering that the Lord had called us to preach the gospel unto them. So soon as he prayed, he went into Asia. He went into Macedonia. And when he got into Macedonia, he went into a few cities. But in verse 14, he ran into a woman named Lydia. He ran into a woman named Lydia. Lydia's name means travail. Her name means travail. What God is saying today, that your travail is over. Your travail is over. Travailing, praying, God, open the door. Open the realm of the Spirit unto me. I hear the Lord saying there are not only ministries here, but there are businesses here. People that have desire to do business. And seems like things have been blocked. Things have been stymied. Things have been hindered. But God says, today I'm going to open the door. Not only for your business, but for your ministry. Matter of fact, everything you apply your hands to, God says, I'm going to open the door for you. Here, the Bible says that Lydia was a seller of purple. She had money.
Come on now.
She had money. And basically, money is the thing that stops us. Amen. Money is the thing that hinders us. We have the anointing. We have the revelation, we have the word, we have the gifts, but one thing that stops us is money. Money. But this woman had money. She had money. She was a seller of purple and a worshiper of God. You can't beat that. Not only did she have money, but she loved the Lord. She loved ministry. She loved the work of the Lord. She had money and she was a worshiper of God. And Paul says she heard us. She had money. She was a worshiper of God. And she had a spiritual ear to hear what the Spirit was saying to the church. Money. Worshiper of God. And can hear from God. The Bible says, whose heart the Lord opened. Whose heart the Lord opened. This word means to open thoroughly. The other word meant gateway, vestibule, channel. This word means to open thoroughly. God says, I'm going to open things thoroughly unto you. Open thoroughly what has been closed. The things that have hindered you, that have stymied you, that have stopped you, howbeit money, whatever, God says, I'm going to open it thoroughly unto you. It means to open the mind, i.e., open the understanding. Some of us, we're praying to God, God, how can I do it? How can I accomplish this? And it hasn't came yet. But he says, I'm going to make it clear to you. I'm going to give you clarity to everything you're trying to accomplish. I'm going to give you clarity. I'm going to open your understanding, your spiritual understanding. I'm going to open your revelation. Everything you're trying to do, God says, I'm going to open it unto you. There will be no more hindrances. There will be no more blocks. As long as you stay fervent in prayer, as long as you continue in the things I've given you, nothing will block you. Nothing will stand in your way. He says, I'm going to open it thoroughly. This woman had money, and she opened things thoroughly unto the Apostle Paul. That had been closed. She opened up the understanding, and even though things were opened unto him, he still had opposition, because in the same place he ran into the young girl, damsel, that had the spirit of divination. But that did not hinder him. And he went to jail and was put in stocks. You know that Paul didn't even have to go to jail. He didn't have to even be put in stocks, because he was a Roman citizen. He could have said, I'm a Roman citizen. I'm not going to go to jail because I'm a Roman. It's not my duty to go. But because Paul loved the gospel, he loved what God said, and he never would take the short way. He never would go the easy way. He went on into jail and was beaten, but at midnight a cry was made, and God brought an earthquake and shook the place, and all of his bonds were released. So even though the door was open, there were still mountains. So he goes into Asia, runs into this woman, Lydia. Things are opened up unto him thoroughly, completely. And understanding was opened. And he goes in there and preaches the gospel. Now, God said, I'm going to give you more than you ever desired or dreamed about. More than your imagination could think about. I'm going to open things up to you. More than your vision. I'm going to supersede your vision. I'm going to go past your vision. I'm going to go way past your vision. I'm going to go way past your dreams, because I'm going to open things up to you. One thing I thought that was very significant, that the Apostle Paul went into Asia, and he was just going to a few cities. He was going to a few cities. But God gave him the whole continent. God's going to give you more than you thought you could dream or imagine. He gave him the whole continent. He went into Corinth. He went into Ephesians and Ephesus. And while he was there, you know, they had he messed up the union, the Smith's union, silversmith's union. He messed that up, and they went crazy and started chanting "Great is Diana" for 3 hours and tried to kill the Apostle Paul. And then they had a big bonfire. They took all their trinkets and all their books on witchcraft and all this, and threw it in the fire. And he ministered to the whole continent. God gave him the whole continent. The Bible says in Acts 19 and 10, and he continued. And this continued by the space of 2 hours, so that all which dwelt in Asia heard the word of the Lord Jesus Christ, both Jews and Greeks. Yeah. God's going to give you more than you thought you can have. Everybody stand. Yes. Gave him the whole continent. The whole continent. This is what I hear the Lord saying, that he's opening thoroughly opportunities to us. That we're going to walk in some places that most black men have never walked in. That I'm going to open up some channels. I'm going to open up some streams. I'm going to open up some portals so you can walk through, and that some of your ministries are going to change. They're going to change. Matter of fact, while you're listening to this word, your ministry is changing. While you're listening to how God is opening up channels, it's changing. God said that there are ministries, there are mantles that I have held up in the heavenlies. and I desire to give them out. But because people's hearts, men and women's hearts, were not right towards me, I've been searching the earth, wanting to give these ministries, wanting to give these mantles out. And right now, I see a people that I can lay these mantles on. I see a people that desire me. I see a people that desire my heart, that want my heart, that are not seeking my face, that's not seeking my hand, but they're seeking the heart of God. They're like Abraham. They desire to have the mind of God. And God says, I'm releasing these anointings. I'm releasing these mantles because I see hearts in here that are pure after the heart of me. So God says, lift your hands and receive that I've held up for years. Receive that I desire to give my men. Receive that I desire to give black men, but their hearts were not after me. They did not have the passion that I desired. So receive that I'm giving, and you will walk in a new anointing. You will walk in a new fire. Nothing will stand in front of you. Nothing will stop you. For I am God, and I come to rejuvenate you. I come to build you up. I come to strengthen you, give you clarity, give you understanding, and allow you to walk in the places that have hindered you. I'll allow you to go into realms. I'll allow you to go into spheres. I'll allow you to go into channels where that no other man has gone in. Open your mouth and worship him. I'm opening doors right now. I'm opening doors. I'm opening doors right now. That has been blocked up. I'm opening. God said, he said in Revelation chapter 3, verse number 7, I open a door that no man can shut. Before you, I set a door open that no man can shut. Take this word. You will see a transformation in your ministry, in your life. Transformation. God said it already started. It started with Apostle, Chief Apostle Prue, opening the door for this ministry, opening the door for this building, opening the door for this building, for this ministry. God says, Apostle, that he's going to send you people that the world has given up on. Mm. People that the world has given up on. Those that seems like they're lost, that they can't find their way. And you're going to stimulate something in them. And he will make apostles, prophets, and teachers out of these men. I see those that have been stillborn, those that have been aborted. God says you're going to breathe life back into those people. Come on, clap your hands and praise them, everybody. Clap your hands and praise them.
We have to create those that were not there. That's part of apostolic grace. Amen. Come on, shout and give God some praise. And I think every apostle will be glad to have a Lydia.
Amen.
Lord, send me a rich businessman or businesswoman who is faithful and loves ministry. Amen. Money answers all things. That's what Solomon said. Amen. Come on, praise him. This apostolic theme, I want to bring up Apostle Kevin Graham for the next half an hour to further take us into understanding of this apostolic dimension. Amen. Come on, man of God.
Now, if we're to make known the wisdom of God to principalities, say, I'm a teacher of all atmospheres. And we're going to pull philosophies down. See, you're a governor.
Hallelujah. Yes, God.
Say, I'm the template. Of what takes place in my region. If it's happening in my region, by surprise, somebody's not doing their job. See, as an apostolic people, we must understand in the last 10 years, we've learned all the lingo. We know all the definitions. We know all the postures. You wear the right gaiters. You wear the right clothes. But here in this move in Cleveland, God is pulling back the very spirit of apostolicity. See, there's three dimensions: outer court, inner court, most holy place. We've been on the outer court of the apostolic grace long enough.
Yes, God.
Because Apostle Peter, he had an apostolic grace, but still had prejudice in him.
Yes, God.
See, the blending of humanistic philosophies can't stand to the matchless mystery made known from his apostles. We have to raise our level of consecration, and that's not a religious term, separating from everybody else's revelation.
Yeah. Wow.
Oh, come on. He made known to me the mystery through him. I encountered the Christos. I encountered the living Christ. I encountered him. I didn't go by someone else's revelation. There was a template imparted into me through the revelation of the person of Jesus Christ. So what we're going to do, say, I'm an irrigator. Every time there's a curse on the land, God has to bring irrigators. A curse can only be broken when there's someone who can negotiate with the God that's against the region. While prophets go on the behalf of the people, we stand in the counsel of God and negotiate the terms whereby, why, God, you don't need to bring this upon this land. I represent you in the earth. And if you do that in the earth, they will say everything the apostles spoken were not so. But there's an eternal counsel. God took me into the heavens. And he showed me a table, apostle proved, it was endless. In this table, I saw a man with a broad chest. He had regalia and rank. Barrel chest guy. And in my spirit, I didn't say it with my mouth. I was communicating in the spirit world. And the question was, who is this? Yep. He said, that's Moses. I said, what? I'm here looking at Moses. I said, who is that? He said, that's David. I said, whose chair is this? He said, that's yours.
Come on.
But when I look, you know how the table runner goes from one place to the next. Uh-huh. It never stops. He said, this is the eternal council that I sit my apostles in. And it's never broken. There's a cloud of witnesses. He's literally showed me the men that had this revelation. And God placed, and they're still at the table watching it unfold. Say, I'm the fulfillment of the sacrifice
of
other apostles. And I'm among the table. And today you're going to sit at the table. You may be seated.
Hallelujah, hallelujah.
The eternality of God is encroaching the earth. Over the precipice of time, God is frustrated because we've taken on a title without being branded by the seal. There's a seal on the inside of every apostle in every region. If it's not broken open, you can't move in that dimension of the apostolic. That governs nature. That governs currency and economy. There's a curse over your land where you're called to. That's why you're there. It's hard. So what? Because if you knew who you were, I'm going to tell you how to function in the spirit of apostolicity, where it will cause you to move, not look for miracles, but be the miraculous.
Yes, yes, yes. Amen.
Now is the time standing in this gathering in Great College of Apostles is because you tried everyone's ethnicity and tried everyone else's way, and it failed you.
Come on.
And you've been tried and you've been buffeted by the enemy because of the abundance of revelation on the inside of you, but you, no one can help you identify that you're the solution to the famine. Say, I'm the solution.
I'm the solution.
To the famine. When God sends an apostle, first of all, we have to understand you're legally authorized to move as God.
Yeah.
Not on his behalf.
Come on.
As God. God's not coming to the earth. Mm-hmm. He sent you legal authorization. The word apple, means to be violently torn away. Apostle Gerald talked about the bark being violently ripped from the bark. Some of you were ripped from jobs and ripped from families and ripped from organizations and ripped in front of your own communities because God violently ripped you from the pattern of the organized crime called religion. You were being groomed to be one of the mob bosses and be aligned in religion, the great harlot of Babylon, but God violently rejected you. God's rejection, man's rejection of you, was God sealing you for this move at this time in the Holy Spirit.
Come on.
Say, I'm an irrigator. Now, I'm going to talk about this because it's important, because you are, say, I'm a hub. I have an economy within myself. That's why people don't help you, apostle, yet. Because God said you have a currency flowing out of you. When you show up, blind eyes come open. When you show up, money comes from everywhere. When you show up, death comes up. Your darkness is gone because you are the manifestation of God's thought in your region.
Wow.
You have to become one with your apostolicity. You're not sure yet. You're not convinced that you're the one. Psychologically, you have to be redeemed psychologically to be an apostle, because if you don't walk with a sound mind, you will have a breakdown. If you haven't been bruised for this yet, you're not qualified for the next level of demonstration. It pleased God to bruise his own son. It pleased him. And I'm coming after the bleeding within your apostolic anointing. You look good on the outside, but your capillaries are ruptured. You look good on the outside, but your faith is ruptured. You look good on the outside, but your mind is cluttered. But I'm here to declare that God's coming back to you and reestablish his covenant with you because you broke the last one. Yeah, you are moving in your gifting, but you're not moving in the seal whereby you were redeemed. You're already redeemed from the earth. Now you have to redeem the earth. Now let's go to the word of God. I feel a shift, and I honor apostle, and I honor all the college of the apostles, but I want to give honor where honor is due. Being a younger generation, I want to bring transgenerational honor to a father in the pioneering of this move of God. I want to honor from a generation that don't honor older men. I want to honor you. Now, irrigation, John 7, the 37th verse. Now, when you begin to talk about the apostolic anointing and an apostolic dimension, you have to understand it's legislative. You have to understand it's governmental. You have a judicial branch. You have a legislative branch. That's why we have different streams. Same spirit, but different administrations. The Obama administration is different from the Bush administration. Totally different, but the same government. You're uniquely different. There's not going to be the same apostles. There's no parakeet pattern. There's no same snowflake. There's no same print of your thumb. You're uniquely different, and that's where the strength of your apostolic grace comes in. When you find your pattern and begin to flourish in the pattern, you can't flourish outside of your pattern. Cause you're in someone else's lane. You have to begin to ask me, God, show me who I was before I came to the earth. Reveal to me who I was before I came into the earth realm. John 7. Thank God for my wife. She keeps me on time. 37th verse. On the last day, say the last day, the great day of the feast, Jesus stood and cried out, saying, if anyone thirst, let him come to me and what? Verse 38. He who believes in me, yes? Come on, believe where? Believe where? Not philosophically reason him. When you begin to change your belief into becoming one with me, out of your belly shall flow irrigation. Believe into my pattern and be me in the earth, then out of your belly, out of the most inner recesses of your spirit, out of the inner recesses of your ministry, will flow an irrigation that cannot be stopped by policies and procedures and witchcraft and darkness, because you're on the inside of me and I've conquered all. Because you notice he just finished the feast. You know that was appointed times. Come on, prophets. God still uses a Hebraic calendar. We just came out of a feast just now. But after the feast, he still cried, said, you missed it because you're moving in a tradition.
Yes, God. Yes, God.
And I never called it to be a tradition. Now we have traditional apostles.
Jesus, mercy.
Now we have professional apostles. Now we have this move where religious people no longer can pimp the move of God out of religion. So they're turning their name apostle, they're keeping the same religious spirit.
Wow.
It's a great deception.
Yes. Oh.
It's not kingdom because you took the, you're wearing jeans. Now I don't mean you're moving in God. It's not because you don't have a limited time of worship. God moves in structure too. But what I'm telling you now, just because you made a few changes, if the spirit of it is still Satan, it's still Satan with an apostolic tag. God told me I'm not going to release you. In 1991, I got born again. God supernaturally saved me. I wasn't a willing worker. I wasn't a nothing. I was high, and God blew my high. And he said, it's time to preach the gospel. I said, what do you mean? Then he started teaching me the prophetic right away. See, but I'm not going to release you because the face of the church will change. He said, the heart of the church will change because I'm going to transform the church. Listen, the last shall be first. Say, I'm a prototype. That word apostolic also means proton. You're first.
Right.
You're the prototype, and you must bring water to a lamb, because when a pastoral driven pulpit centered ministry is in the right, it's in the center of it all, they don't have the grace to sustain monitoring prophets and legislating heavenly matters. They crumble under the pressure. Because it's not their grace. Their grace is to be shepherds. Their grace is to shear the sheep. Their grace is to love the people. But we have a grace where you can be pastored up under an apostle and have the apostolic grace while you pastor. That's why pastors are asleep. They're sick. I told you, you're not going to have me eating Jell-O at the convalescent home having a stroke because you put me in a dimension that God don't want me in. I'm not eating Jell-O with the blue and green pill and you come. irrigation, Isaiah 35, 5 through 6. Now this is what Isaiah saw 600 years before the reality of this, of the reality of Jesus Christ being manifested in the earth. I told you they were sitting at a table. So Isaiah heard this in the meeting. Prophets take minutes in the spirit world. A prophet sees it, but an apostle has the ability to be an architect and say, let me see the timing and the season when we're going to implement that. Be very careful, prophets, to try to manipulate your apostle to do something that's not time.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Because you see it, you don't have the authorization to unlock it in your region. He has it. Or she has it. And don't be held hostage by a prophet because they see something. Quit being so insecure because God has a lot of gifted people around you. You have the government. They just have a badge. They can't fire you, but you can fire them. Watch this. We'll look at the design and the pattern of heaven. Okay. Hallelujah. The eyes of the blind. Isn't this a stream that loves miracles? Watch this. When you're in your proper positioning in the spirit world, you're praying. See, you're praying external first in this era. You got to identify what he downloaded in you. Then agree with what he's revealing.
My God.
A house divided against itself can't what? You want the external house in order and you don't know. You're divided on what he's doing. Get in agreement with what he's revealing in your spirit and start decreeing it as if it's already in the earth. The eyes of the blind shall be open. The ears of the deaf shall be unstopped. The lame shall leap like a deer. Do you see all these manifestations of what was opposite? This is what happens when apostolic anointings and government come in alignment with who they are. The ground begins to change. Clarity begins to come. That's why religion has kept the pastor as the king of the hill. Because Satan rather have a pastor out of place than have an apostle governing, because you challenge the system of darkness. And you are the ensign. Say, I'm an ensign. I'm a manifestation that God is not dead. Say, I'm a pattern. And wherever my government sends me, I have the backing. Whether it's warfare or economically. Wherever I go, where it's not, I just get in agreement because I'm the altar in the earth that legalized God. Say, I legalize God. You're worried about legalizing marijuana. God said, when you're going to allow me, you the representative to legalize me. Jesus could not come into the earth by spirit alone because he would have been illegal. Spirit world has rules and rights. You can't come down here and manifest. You remember when Jesus came, not as Christ, but as Jesus of Nazareth? Then he healed somebody and say, have you come to torment us before time? Even the demonic realm knew he was not the Christ yet. He had not died yet. He got to raise before you kick us out. He said, be quiet. Shut up and go into that fat back and pig feet. Get into it. You're not supposed to reveal who I am yet. Because in the cosmic realm, we battled so long. I beat you in dimensions where you had to digress. Now I finally found you here in this realm, and you're trying to reveal who I am prematurely. Many of you went premature. And it cost you everything. But God is resetting your destiny today. Push the reset button in the spirit world. Before you get a new download, they say turn your computer what? God turned you off the last 3 months. You're functioning, but you knew you was off. You're giving a word. You know you off. You didn't feel nothing. But you know why you still can do it? It's a pattern. It's a template. I still can. That's the danger of you. You're so gifted, but you don't know you've been disconnected. God is the only one that can fire you and still use you. You may have had a pink slip and didn't even know it. Israel didn't even know Ichabod was written over them until the prophet came back and said, listen, after 40 years, the glory's gone. They were functioning 40 years in religious activity. Closing it down. I feel such a release in this place. Hallelujah. The lame leap like a deer. Those are systems that were created to move swiftly. As a deer headed for the water. Our people we serve, they're like deer. And they're crippled because their environment has been taken. Now they have to run across I-90. When the apostolic anointing and government is not in your community, business goes down. Wow. See, you're not called to pastor a church. You're called to facilitate God in civilization. Let me take you to the Noahic covenant. And I'm working on a book called The Proton Family. And part of y'all are that. That's why we came on the slave ships last. You are a prototype of civilization. Hear that. That's why you can't die. That's why the upheaval is going on. I was in Ferguson while they were going wild to discern the climate and culture. But you know what I found? It's a prophetic in the apostolic generation that says we're not going to be smacked upside the head another day. Matter of fact, we're organizing a solution. Those are our dears. Because y'all gave up. Now it's falling on them. They're strong enough to jump, run through troops and leap over walls. But they're so silly, they need a mind and a government so it can be sustained. Amen. Noah was called. Only 8 souls got saved. But he got put into something he never built before. He had to touch stuff that he never knew, rain, because there was a canopy over the earth. Then there was, water came under the ground. See, you've been looking for the heavens, God bringing it underground. You've been looking everywhere but underground. So God has been establishing a system in you. Why am I buried? Why am I underground? Because your foundation, apostolic giftings and colors, they're the foundation. Nobody comes around the world to see what's under this carpet. But we're sitting on it and it's beautiful. But that's not the foundation. That's the accoutrement of it. Now, the foundation of the new civilization was in an ark. He said, I'm so tired of you. Noah, you build this boat because you're going to watch your cousins die. Can you imagine watching everything around you dying and the thing that caused everybody else to die, you still survive it? That's what we call apostolic buoyancy. You go down, but you bounce up. It's in your molecular structure in the spirit world that, listen, you can come against them, but you can't have their soul. Job, where my Job's at? Now, this is what he did. He said, I had to put a burial ground around Noah. Apostolic grace started in the grave.
Oh God.
That's your first ministry. What shift you on, graveyard shift?
Come on, God.
It starts in the grave. That's why Jesus, when he started moving in his ministry, he had to go to the man at the graveyard and deal with the Gadarenes. That was in the Decapolis. Say 10. The time of probation. Inside of the demoniac, watch this. Watch what apostles do. They see maximum impact in demonized people.
Wow.
Now I'm going to show you the history of why. Everything Jesus did was strategic. Irrigation. He was the living water, right? So he had to go pour water in the graveyard where demonic powers had abused an uncovered young man. He was cutting himself. Society didn't want him, and he spoke to him. But guess what? In history, after he set him free, he went and released the water of God to 10 different areas in that region. That's why God sends you people that seem like they're off the charts. But once they come into an alignment with an apostolic anointing, they will facilitate what's inside of you.
Yes, come on now.
God gives you the hard jobs because you have the grace to do it. But once they catch it, they're going to be 10 more times effective than the ones you won't.
Come on. Wow.
Noah gets in the boat. Noah goes through 40 days of a systematic reform. God said, I'm going to reform civilization. I don't need no preacher for that. I need an apostle for that. Economic reform, educational reform, political reform. Take your cross off, get you a business suit, get you something else to do, and go sit at the table where the heathens are.
Yes, God
created the heathens. Now it's time for him to impart. Now, Noah gets to the place of Mount Ararat, and the Bible says that the water assuaged. God knows when to speak to your floodwaters. And the water began to recede on a mount called, what is it?
Ararat.
Now, God used him to build something he never built before, move his family, and manage the crisis of the animals. He was so awesome that he managed them without being eaten. Real government would cause animals not to consume each other.
That's right.
In the time of your flood, you need government. That's why we're here. You need to be in government. Can you imagine a snake getting along with a rat? That joke would have been ate. Big as I am, I would have ate everything. Now, he said the water began to assuage when it hit at a certain place. You're anointed about to hit at a certain place. You're about to get in a certain place. The Bible declared when Jacob got to a certain place, heaven opened.
Yes, come on. All right.
You're about to get into a prophetic and an apostolic certain place. That means when you unequivocally, irrevocably, absolutely know that God has called you and you were born for this. If you're not sure for that, sit on. Don't go with the big dog. If you're not absolutely, irrevocably, positively sure that you're called for this, go sit down and play church. This is a tailor-made suit and a tailor-made dress. This mantle can't be stolen. It's tailor-made. Now, he got on Mount Ararat, then God started changing things. You're almost at the peak of Mount Ararat where the word of God says that Mount Ararat means the place where the curse is reversed. I break every curse over your apostolic grace and your emergence. I break every curse over your expansion. I break the spirit of error that's coming against the apostolic move in your life. I take authority over the spirit of the storm that hinders your advancement. I sever every cord in Cleveland, Ohio. Hear the word of the Lord. The apostles are here. The apostles are here. I make an announcement that who is the King of Glory? appeal.
We renounce the appeal.
And we drop the charges.
On
what we thought you were going to do. But with a more excellent way. We come in agreement. Forgive the last apostolic move. For their error. We recommit our lives. As apostles. And apostolic people. To do your will. Your way. In Jesus' name. Let's please receive Chief Apostle.
For a week. My God. Oh, Jesus. Wow. All I can say is, wow, I can't. God is in God. And that's a young man. Those are the young lions coming out. My God, my God. I heard God say it is his desire to change the atmosphere over Cleveland.
Yes.
For several decades, Cleveland has been considered to be the place of failure.
Wow.
But God said he brings an end to that.
Yes.
He said it can't come through the political realm. We thought it was coming through a basketball player, but that didn't work. God said it's the apostolic church and the apostolic people who begin to understand their role. I hear the Lord say this to us today. This gathering is not coincidental or accidental. It is a divinely ordered time to begin to bring Cleveland to the place to come out of despair. Cleveland's been in despair for years. They laugh about Cleveland. They joke about Cleveland. Come on, somebody. And every strategy that Cleveland has tried to reinvent itself has left Cleveland basically the same. But God said, as his apostolic people understand their authority, then we will see Cleveland come into its prophetic purpose. Every city, every region, every nation, every state has a prophetic purpose. And so God has gathered us to put a down payment on it. What I understand now is no group of people, no specific apostle has it all. God uses each person or group or stream as a portion. And God has called us together to take a portion to restore this region. Somebody shout, say amen.
Amen.
1 hour open mic time. We did that yesterday. We had just an intimate gathering just for my network of apostles. And God just dropped in on us and he blew it up and he visited us and ministered to us and spoke to us. It was just absolutely amazing. I understand this, that nobody knows it all. And apostles are pregnant. And let me just be very clear with you. This is not time to say, thank God I'm here. Say, sanctified by the Holy Ghost, that would have mighty by fire. This is apostolic time. If you get up to say something, you better have something to say.
All right now.
Amen. Related to the apostolic, let's stay focused on where we are. So glad to see Apostle McKinney here. One of the oldest apostolic, and I don't say chronologically, I'm saying in terms of experience and history. One of the oldest apostolic voices in this region. Pioneered much of what many, many people are walking in today. They apostolically opened the door years ago. Somebody say amen. So for the ones here, come out and prophesy, Kim. Amen? God bless you. The mic is open, but again, we have a strict rule. Very short, quick, and let's have apostolic information. The mic is open.
Oh, Gary Pleasant. Gary Pleasant. During the worship time, I saw an angel coming into Cleveland carrying a big sword, and it was wheeling that sword back and forth. And I said, Lord, what is that? And he said that the angel is cutting and preparing the way for the apostolic move of God. And it was almost like a violent moving of the sword, just cutting, demolishing, and destroying foundations and things that have grown up, but God's cutting it. He's cutting it. He's cutting it. And so to keep moving, the other thing I saw was in Isaiah 25. I want to read a few verses. It says, O Lord, thou my God, I will exalt thee. I will praise thy name, for thou hast done wonderful things. Thy counsels have done wonderful things. Verse 2, for thou hast made a city and heap of a defense city, a ruin, a palace of strangers to be no city. It shall never be built. Therefore shall the strong people glorify thee. The city of the terrible nations shall fear thee. For thou hast been a strength to the poor, a strength to the needy in his distress, a refuge from the storm, a shelter from the heat. Verse 5, thou shalt bring down the noise of strangers as the heat in a dry place, even the heat with the shadow of a cloud, the branch of the terrible one shall be brought low. And in this mountain shall the Lord of hosts make unto all people a feast of fat things, a feast of wines in the lees, of fat things full of marrow, of wines on the lees well refined. Now listen to this verse. And he will destroy in this mountain the face of the covering cast over all people, and the veil that is spread over all nations. He will swallow up in death. He will swallow up in death in victory. And the Lord will wipe away tears from all faces, and the rebuke of his people shall he take away from all the earth, for the Lord hath spoken it. And in verse 7, this God says, I'm going to destroy in this mountain the face of the covering cast over all people. And Isaiah 60 talks about different levels of darkness, the gross darkness that covers the people, the gross darkness. It speaks of darkness and the gross darkness. And so what I saw was Cleveland or the surrounding area, there's been like a cloud in terms of revelation. And I'm not saying God hasn't been speaking or anything like that, but there's been like a cloud, and that cloud, the Lord says, I'm removing the covering cast of the cloud. And what the cloud does, it blocks the revelation or the church from seeing and comprehending the revelation of God. And so tying it together, this angel that God released was sent to break and tear down and cut this cloud of revelation. The apostolic move of God is not an idea of man. This is an idea of God born before the foundation of the world. And anytime God is going to do something in a city, in a region, God sets in his church apostles first. And that is not our idea. And we've done pastors and we've done bishops, and we're not against any of that. We've set up different titles and denominations and all of these things. But if we're going to see a move of God, God will set in that city or in that region the apostolic anointing, the apostolic mantle. And so what the apostolic mantle will do is it will break, it will remove that cloud of revelation, that covering cast, that stronghold of the enemy. And so I speak today, I decree today, I speak the word of God, that this stronghold that has kept or hindered the move of God from rising up is being broken in the name of Jesus. The cloud of revelation, there's a revelation that is being released in Cleveland that has been kind of, how can I put it? It's kind of been spurting up here and there, but now it's going to grow. The seed is being planted. It's going to grow and it's going to break through and it's going to break open the purpose of God. And man of God, I hear the Lord saying to you that this is not an idea of yours, even in being in this building. This is a new day. This is a day of revelation. God is going to use you to bring companies of apostolic leaders from around the world. I see people from Africa. I see people from Europe. I see people from Asia. I see people from South America. I see a gathering coming together. And it's not just titles, it's the mantle of God, because God said this is the time for Cleveland. That cloud is being removed, it's being brought back, it's being pushed back. And I just want to read one verse in Isaiah 60. Arise, shine. And I believe this is a word of the Lord to apostles. Apostle John Eckhart has released a book called Prophets Arise. But what I hear the Lord saying is, apostles, arise. Arise, shine, for thy light is come, and the glory of the Lord. That's what Cleveland needs. The glory of God is risen upon thee. For behold, the darkness, that's that covering cast in Isaiah 25. For behold, the darkness shall cover the earth and gross. So there's two levels of darkness. And gross darkness, or thick darkness to people. Ignorance, lack of understanding, lack of knowing our purpose, lack of the call of God, being intimidated by who we are. But the Lord shall rise upon thee, and his glory shall what? Shall be seen upon thee. And the Gentiles shall come to thy light, revelation, and kings to the brightness of thy rising. Lift up thine eyes round about thee, and they gather together. And then it goes on, and people coming from all over the world, all over the world. This is going to be a center of an apostolic move of God. This is going to be a center of an apostolic move of God. This is going to be a center of an apostolic move of God that has been brewing in the region. The prayer has been going on. It's been kind of underground, as you've been saying, but now the time has come. So Father, we thank you. Pray with me just for a moment. Father, we thank you that this covering cast, I decree that the covering cast, the darkness, the blindness, the ignorance, the lack of receiving apostolic anointing and grace in this city is broken in the name of Jesus. We break it by the Spirit of God. We say that you cannot stay. We say that as you laughed about the apostolic in times past, you're going to begin to recognize not just men and women, but you're going to recognize the move of God, the mantle of God, the decree of God, and God set in the church. And so I say, apostles, arise. Apostles, arise. Come out of hiding. Come out of darkness. Come out of that place of being hidden, and arise and be the men and women of God that God has called you to be, in Jesus' name.
First of all, I have to apologize. Apostle, you know I love you. But I will say to God, this man had more church than anybody I know. That was my only complaint. Let me tell you something. About maybe a little over a week ago, I was talking about you. And I told him, I said, I love that brother. He's always got a word in his mouth. But he had more church than anybody I know. And before I could really get the conversation out of my mouth, I was talking to my daughter, the other one. And I heard the Holy Spirit say, "Spoil me." It's a voice, I heard it. And I just wanted to shrink into the floor. And he said, how do you know that I'm not directing him that way?
That's right, that's right. Come on down.
I just wanted to shrink. So I said before you opened it and said, I apologize. Brother, you can have as much church you want. I ain't got nothing to say. Last night, I was talking with my brother, and you know, as usual, we was talking about the little 5-month-old little girl. First of all, I want to say I agree with everything you said. The prep, everything you said, you just right on it. We were talking about the 5-month-old little girl that got killed.
Yes, yes, God.
And you know, the question comes to your mind, what's happening?
Yes, God.
What's going on, God?
God.
Yeah.
Now, I know, like everyone in this room know, God's in control.
Yeah. Yeah.
And when it's all over, he's going to have the final say so.
Yes. Yes.
The devil's not going to outdo God. Because God's not allowing it.
Right.
Now, right now, it looks like the enemy's in control.
Looks like.
And he's winning.
Come on.
And you know, I told my church last Sunday, I said, you know, what our problem is, we're so busy looking this way at the natural and all this going on and the killing and all everything that we're not looking this way.
Right.
And we're not seeing the many souls that have been saved.
Lord.
We're not seeing the mass of people being healed. My daughter-in-law is on a 2-week mission trip and she was struggling with her walk with Jesus and she's on fire because she says, the thousands of young people,
thousands.
I think she's in Singapore,
thousands.
That's at the altar,
Jesus.
Crying out, saying, asking God to come into their heart.
Yeah.
She said she went on a medical mission with Joyce Meyer, I think it is. And the people that are coming to the clinic to be healed through medicine and through prayer. So God is working.
He's working.
Yeah.
But because we can't see what he's doing,
because
he's been looking this way.
Yeah.
And all we see is what's on the news and what's going on, you know, and it's look like it's just everything's so crazy. So last night, Adam Property's school book, I can't remember which one, picked this book up. And in the Message Bible, this is what it says. It's in the first chapter. Let me see what verse I want to start with. Maybe verse 4. This is the Message. And this is concerning the young people who it seems like they lost their mind. They have no respect for anything or anybody. They don't have respect for the church. I mean, there was a time when they knew that you was an apostle, a pastor, a Christian. If they was in your presence, they would respect you. They don't respect you. They don't care nothing about you. And so, it says, one generation goes its way, the next one arrives, but nothing changes. Talk about our young people. It's business as usual for old planet Earth. The sun come up, the sun goes down. Then does it again and again. The same old round. The wind blows south, the wind blows north. Around and around it blows. Blowing this way, then that. The whirling, the erratic wind. All the rivers flow into the sea. But the sea never fills up. The rivers keep flowing to the same old place. And then start all over and do it again. Everything, and this is where the young people are coming in at. Everything's boring. Utterly boring. No one can find any meaning in it. Boring to the eyes. Boring to the ears. Our young people are so bored.
Yes. That's true.
And they got so much idle time on their hands.
Yes, yes.
And the devil comes in and fills their minds and show them how they can do this and do that. And they always think they'll be the one that's going to get away with it. Bobby got caught, but I'm not going to get caught.
Come on.
But see, the Bible says in verse 9, what was will be again. What happened will happen again. There is nothing new on this earth. And King James said nothing new under the sun. Yea, year after year, it's the same old thing.
Yes.
does someone call out, hey, this is new? Don't get excited. Right. It's the same old story.
Come on.
Nobody remembers what happened yesterday.
Yeah.
And the thing that will happen tomorrow, nobody remembers them either. Don't count on being remembered. The young people don't care. They don't care. And so the Bible says there's nothing new under the sun. So what has happened? They said September was the worst, bloodiest month in God knows when. But the Bible says there's nothing new under the sun. So this cycle happened before.
Right.
It came a different way, a different color, but it came before. And then before that, it came again. And then before that, it came again. It came back in my grandmother's time and my great-grandmother's time. There's nothing new under the sun. All this marching and carrying signs, that ain't the answer.
All right.
I don't believe in that. If I'm wrong, I apologize.
It ain't right.
But marching and carrying the sun ain't gonna bring no solution. The apostolic, the prophets, the ministers, we gotta rise, as my brother said, and take authority over the situation, because that's the only way it's gonna change. And give us wisdom, God, how to reach our young people. Give us wisdom and let them know God ain't the way. Back in my day, you fought. Days is over with.
Right. All right.
We have got to arise.
Yes, God.
I got another confession. This I apologize to Pastor Nelson. I was praying he was going to be apostle. I really was. This I apologize to him. And then once again, apostle, I got to apologize to you. I went out of town about a month ago with my daughter. She had to preach prophet scam. And so this little bitty woman, I just talked, white lady, little bitty thing, came over to me. First, she prayed for my body and stuff. And then, I don't know if anybody was paying attention, because I was kind of new there. They didn't know me. And I was praying. I was scraping. Maybe nobody really heard. But I got this mild rebuke again. Jesus, from the Lord. And this lady said to me, she was talking, apostle, now Lord, I don't even know what her name is. But she said to me, when you accept your position, I'm going to heal your body. I could not accept being apostle.
Jesus.
This man kept calling me apostle, and I kept saying, Lord, he bless his heart because he don't know what he's talking about. And then here you come. And I'm thinking, these two men,
come on.
I wish they'd stop. They don't know what they're saying.
Jesus.
But she said to me, it switched from the healing of the body and the sweet apostolic lady to this rebuke. When you accept the call in that place, don't you? And you're going to see the healing manifest in your body.
Come on.
Once again, I have to say, God, just open it. Let me go through. Just let me go. Because this is too much.
Jesus.
And so, I'm working on it. I'm improving. I'm not totally there. I ain't going to lie. I'm working on it.
Glory God.
And I think probably a lot of it got to do with the way I was brought up and how I was trained in church and stuff like that. But I figured, hey, let me confess. Let me say I'm sorry. Let me repent. And this man right here, I don't want to see my hand. But anyway, I'm sorry. This is what God gave me last night.
Amen.
We do have to rise and take our position. Not just title-wise. Not just walking in the church and they say, well, here come apostle.
Right.
You go and you take your seat. It's not that.
No. Right.
Taking your position is walking in it.
Amen.
And
amen.
Taking it.
Yeah.
Taking it.
Yeah.
Letting Satan know you got authority. Because I think sometimes he forgets we got authority. And sometimes I think we forget we got authority. Bless you.
Amen. I'm Apostle Drew Harris from California, headed to Atlanta, Georgia. That's my lovely wife right back there. And I agree with everything that has been said before me. Now, I just want to tag something on to what has been said. I'm new at this, but I've accepted the fact that I am an apostle.
Yes.
But I'm new at it. Now, what has happened is about 3 weeks after God called me to be an apostle, he took me into a dream and he showed me off to the spirits that were in the Atlanta area. And as they peered at me, now I understand that he was showing them that I have legal authority, that I'm coming there to set in order what needs to be done and to make them understand that they're illegal in that area. And he began to show me and tell me who they were. I was new at this. And he said, the first one, it was a mountain lion coming down, peering at me. He wasn't in attack mode, but he was just checking me out. Now, I'm used to binding spirits and doing all that, but God just said, just listen. And then he told me the second one was a spirit of pride. The first one was perversion. And he said, and the third one is an addictive spirit of pharmacos.
Amen.
I haven't even got to Atlanta yet. And God is already showing me what I need to deal with. So I know that we have to take authority. We have to walk in our apostleship. We have to know that we are God's person in that earth. And we do need to know what we're confronted with so that we can take authority over it. And then our cities will change.
Amen.
So I'm going to do something different. I wanted to do some teaching during lunch, but I just felt impressed to just share something. I just really impressed in my spirit. I wrote a book about 2 years ago called Apostolic Metrics. And God showed me some insight into understanding the apostolic at another level. How many have ever done some things that you had no scripture for, but you know you were led to do it? And you out there because you've been trained. You said, I ain't got no verse for this, Lord.
All right.
But every time I stop trying to do it, you keep telling me to do it, but I can't prove it.
All right.
Hello? Yes. And God will let you walk there for a while, but ultimately he will give you scripture.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And so for years, I have been putting people in place as apostles. And God would lead me, guide me, direct me to do it. I would walk away and say, God, this seem like I'm making everybody an apostle. I said, God, this don't make no sense to me. And he kept saying to me, do what I told you to do. And I kept saying, but God, it doesn't make sense. I'm even being criticized for that. He said, just do what I told you to do. I've never been there.
Amen.
You know you heard from God.
Amen.
But you couldn't prove it.
Yeah.
But ultimately, he brought me to a place where I could prove it. And he began to say to me, we have looked at apostles as one monolithic, single manifestation, but it's much broader than that. Now, we understand there are all kinds of classes of apostle, but God showed me something as it relates to the metrons, or apostolic measurement. Mm-hmm. Every apostle has a different measure. Or let's use this word, license. When you start driving a car, they do not give you a permanent license immediately. You get a what? Temporary license to see whether or not you'll act crazy. Hello? And so I discovered that there is a temporary apostolic license, and the Greek word for it is the word pempo, P-E-M-P-O. That word means to be temporarily licensed. Somebody shout.
Right.
To be an apostle. Anyone that sits under an apostle, you are automatically granted a pempo, temporary apostolic anointing to be part of that apostolic team. God gave me this clarity because the only person or office that has a legal right to start a church in the heavens are pastors, are our apostles.
Yep.
But you and I know there are many pastors that have started churches successfully.
Mm-hmm.
And some of them doctrinally don't even believe in apostles. But God said, God, how does that work? And God said to me, he said, the heavens only respond to an apostolic anointing to make room for a church.
Yeah.
And so God said, even though they may come from Moody Bible Institute, they may not believe nothing.
All right.
I still put a temporary pimple apostolic license on them so that they can have authority to make room in the heaven to open a church. Mm-hmm. Somebody say amen.
Yeah.
So there is a pimple temporary apostolic grace that rests on people, whether that are associated with apostolic people or have an apostolic purpose.
Yeah.
Are you listening to me?
Thank you,
now, unfortunately, what happens with that, as people come on these pempo, temporary apostolic anointings, and they don't proceed when the license has lifted.
Wow.
Hello, somebody. That's why you have what we call dry apostles. What do I mean by a dry apostle? There's no manifestation that gives evidence that there's an apostolic grace there.
All right. Amen.
If you are a covering apostle, someone is going to see you as their mama or daddy without you romancing them.
Wow.
You got a shot in the house. Hello. Not because your car, not because your house, not because your building. Somebody deep is going to call to your deep. Come on, somebody. Bible said every word has a mate. Isaiah 30. Every word has a mate. So if there's a word in a man, there's a mating word waiting to mate with that person. If you're a father, there's a son looking for a father. Amen? But what happens is some people get a temporary apostolic license to perform a certain task, and then they go take the title apostle, and the license has expired. And they say, I'm apostle this. Hello, somebody. And then they go through a whole religious ceremony. Come on, somebody. People point all on their head, all on their toe. Come on, somebody. The whole nine yards. And the heavens are saying, your license is expired. Because watch this. The papal anointing is only good synergistically. What I mean by that? It is only good as you stay in relationship with that gift that God used to grant you the license. See, in this grace movement time, we don't like that kind of stuff. Because we don't like hierarchy. And so there's no hierarchy. Isn't that the craziest teaching in the world? There's no order, there's no structure, there's no government. Everybody on the same level. So you mean I've been at this for 45 years, taking every kind of hit, come on somebody, every kind of pain, failure, getting up, over and over, and you got saved yesterday, and you on the same level as me, you crazy, your God's crazy, the Bible ain't real. Come on somebody, shout out. You got to earn something, the Lord. So there is the papal temporary license.
And God showed me, I said, oh God, I got it now. Now I understand why you had me ordain all these apostolic people. And here was my dilemma. Some of my ordained never walked in it. Wow. I said, God, wow. that's your reproach. He said, it had nothing to do with you.
Right. Yeah, right. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
That don't make me bad. No, it doesn't make a state of Ohio bad. If they grant you a temporary driver's license and you get drunk, that's your fault. You didn't see my mistake. The state I gave you a chance.
Yes, God. Yes, God.
Oh, my God.
Hey,
and see, because we don't understand these metrons, hello, somebody.
Yes, God. Yes, God.
We don't respond. We don't respond correctly. Mm-hmm. See, watch this. It's just like the prophetic. If you're in a prophetic house, you're going to receive a corporate, papal, prophetic anointing.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Mm-hmm.
Yes, what some folks do, they come into a house, they never prophesied in their life, like Mary and Aaron. Mm-hmm. According to the scripture, we have no record of Mary and Aaron doing anything prophetically until Moses came.
All right.
The next year, they big, large, and in charge. We prophesied just like Moses. Come on, somebody. Yeah. And God put on a body and came down.
Jesus.
And I said, hear me.
Right.
If a man be a prophet, I'll speak to him in a vision and a dream. But my servant Moses is himself. He's faithful. Now, the word faithful, here, watch this. The word faithful is the Hebrew word, the namin. The word is namin. It's an office. The office of the faithful one.
Wow.
And so what is God saying? You think you're just dealing with a man. But this man is in an office. It's the office of the Namim. Which means he has a long record before me. He didn't start this yesterday. There's a long history. And what you got in his house. The scripture says, he is faithful in all my house. You are in the house of Moses. And he gave you a temporary gift to help him. It could be extended to permanent. Hello, somebody. But if he revokes it, I can't change it. And so I walked through that. I said, God, I'm ordaining all these apostles. And God said, yeah, guess what? He says, now it ain't special no more. He said, one of the reasons you don't want to do that is you want to be the only one.
Wow.
We don't like to give away what we think makes us illustrious and different. Come on, somebody. I had an apostolic son. I won't give you his name. He doesn't live here, so he wouldn't know him. But we met him in New York City. He was about as broke could be. Preaching a church there. And I was driving back to the George Washington Bridge. And the apostle there took us to eat. And this boy was sitting outside, him and his wife, and eight children in the car stand?
Jesus.
Something like that. And this apostle wouldn't even bring him in to eat. I felt so bad. I made him sit out there. I think armor band goes too far when it came to that. But anyway, I seen him about a year later, I was driving down Warrensville, and I went to a restaurant, and there he was. I said, my God, how did you get here? And God immediately told me. He said, I want you to father him, go back to New York, and plant a church. And we did that. We went back to New York, planted a church in Harlem. He grew for a while. I made him part of my network over the whole region of the state of New York. We had about 5 churches there. And one day he told me, I'm what you are. Mm-hmm. Now, I'm a nice guy. The problem was a Negro when I met you, boy. But watch. I learned something. This is a rabbit trail, but I learned something. I got so angry in my flesh, I disconnected from him.
Mm-hmm.
1 year later, his wife died.
Mm-hmm.
And this is how she died. She was walking, and she scratched her leg and got a staph infection and died.
Mm-hmm.
And when she died, God said to me, that's your fault.
Mm-hmm.
I said, how could that be, Lord? He said, because I never told you to take his license. He said, because he did not have enough strife to keep his wife alive. Are you hearing me? So there's a temporary pimple. Now, if you're in an apostolic house, guess what? That's on you whether you like it or not. Hello?
Amen.
Woman of God, now that you step into the apostolic, all your folks gonna change. Some of them gonna make progression like they've never been through in their life. Hello, somebody gonna rise to places where they've never been to or thought they could go. As with the man God always shared, when an apostle comes, the atmosphere changes. Now let me share another metric. This is going to bless you. Don't pray for me, my voice comes back. This never happens to me, but it happened. I don't know why. I don't know how.
In the name of Jesus.
But it did. Thank you, Lord. Now, I'm going to look at another aspect of this. We'll bless you. This is called the accompanying apostle. It's another grace, another dimension. Look at Acts chapter 20, verse 4. He was accompanied by Sophia, the son of Pyrrhus from Berea, Archytas, Syndicus from Thessalonica, Gaius from Derbe, Timothy, Tychius, and Trimopius from Asia. Now the Greek word there is synapostolos, which means synergistically apostolic, which means this: as I am connected to the chief apostle, when I say chief apostle, I'm not talking about the office, as I am connected to that office, my apostolic license is synapostolos. It is extended for a longer season. Watch what Paul said. Watch this. 2 Corinthians 12:18. I desired Titus, and with him I sent a brother. Did Titus make gain of you? Walked we not in the same spirit and in the same steps? So what was he saying? Titus walked among you like me. When you saw Titus, you saw me. Because Titus has my spirit. He accompanies me. So he no longer has a pimple license. I have extended his license. Because of connection and relationship.
Somebody better shout.
See, God takes this apostolic thing seriously. We don't.
Very serious.
We run around and just take these designations and can't even explain it. Don't even know it. You know, it aggravates me. I was doing a school of prophets just recently in Elkhart, Indiana, a good son of mine. At the beginning of the school, I called him. I said, I want to know how many people here are prophets. And a bunch of people got up. I said, you're a prophet? Yes, I'm a prophet. I said, okay, give me the word of the Lord. Well, I said, how could you be a prophet and you don't have a word?
That's right.
Walk worthy of your vocation.
Amen.
It'd be like me going to the dentist, man, and God said, I got the anointing today. If you're an apostle and there's no signs, there's no wonders, and there's no miracles, you are not an apostle.
Jesus.
We tried it again.
All right.
And I don't like to agree with the notion that apostle needs a prophet. Because apostles stand in every office.
That's right.
When I hear people tell me, hello, someone, well, I'm just an apostle, I don't prophesy. You're not an apostle. Because if you're an apostle, you have the fullness of the measure of the stature of Jesus Christ. Come on, somebody. Paul said, I fully preach the gospel. Hello, somebody. I operated in all of it. But it's only by degrees. Metrics. Somebody say metrics. Stay with me. Are you getting something? We're moving through this quickly. Listen to this. It's called Apostolic Transfer. Oh, God, this is going to cut us all up. Cuts me up every time I read my own book. Luke chapter 23, verse 6 through 7. When Pilate heard of Galilee, he asked whether the man were a Galilean. And as soon as he knew that he belonged under Herod's jurisdiction, he sent him to Herod, who himself also was at Jerusalem at that time. Now the word there is anapempo. That means to transfer apostolically.
All right.
What's that mean? That means as an apostle, no matter how big I am or great I am, I ain't got it all.
All right.
And there should be a brother somewhere that you could lend a son to and say, go over there and sit for a while so you can pick up his spirit, because I don't have that.
Come on now. All right.
Oh, come on, somebody help me. Why are we afraid to fellowship sometime? Because we're afraid to lose folks. I know what New Hope has. I know what we don't. When I go over to Christian Fellowship, there's a worship anointing there that's second to
none. Right.
Hello? Because it's been plowed out for generations. Come on, somebody. Anapempo means an apostle will say, listen, I'm send my son over there. Can you mashak him? Can you just wipe on him what's on you? Come on, somebody. If we don't have no integrity, the son won't come home. And that's why we're so dysfunctional. One of the greatest experiences I've had in the last 2 years, 3 years, is I got out the box.
Praise God.
I'm reading books by people who are not approved. You know what I mean? They ain't in the Word, charismatic. They ain't in none of it. They ain't on GBN. They ain't approved by Tulsa. Come on, somebody. I'm getting some other stuff. And finding out God got some stuff he is saying that is not coming out my tribe.
Come on.
And it's blowing my mind.
Glory to God.
So anapempo means apostolic transfer. I'm sending my son over because y'all got healing. We don't. And we need healing in my house. I'm the leader. I can't go. Are you healing a healing problems? I'm bringing all my people.
Come on, yes.
I'm not afraid. Hello, somebody. Yeah. If they come there, they might stay. If they stay, they didn't belong to me from the beginning anyway.
Yes, God.
Right.
Praise God.
Apostolic transfer.
That's good.
I could go into it in much more detail, but I won't.
Excuse me, where was that? Luke what?
That's Luke. Chapter 23, verse 6 through 7. Let me give you some more verses to back that up. Let's look at Philemon chapter 1, verse 1 through 2. Paul, a prisoner of Jesus Christ, and Timothy, our brother, unto Philemon, my dearly beloved, and a fellow laborer. Philemon was an apostle. Anytime you see the word fellow laborer, co-laborer, it always means this was the title that active apostles used at that time to grant to greet their brethren.
Right.
My co-laborer, my fellow worker.
Yes. Yes.
All right? To our beloved, our pious, Archytas, our fellow soldier, and to the church in our house. And you know what happened in Philemon? It all was about a transfer. Paul temporarily had someone on this and this, believe it was correct, not correct, and it had to be a transfer. Here's one of the things I had to learn as an apostle. I'm not going to cover everybody. I'm going to coach some people. I'm going to mentor some people. And guess guess what? When you learn that, you won't hurt so much. Because the one thing that will kill you in the apostolic is the betrayals. The betrayals. I was talking to my own apostle one day. He had me laughing. He said, "Prue, I don't even know how I drink water." I said, "Why?" He said, "I got so many holes in my back." But when you understand, sometimes this anointing that's operating on me is at a pimple. I'm just here. You got transferred to me for a season. So understand, you're never going to pay me a tithe. I understand you may not even come to a meeting. You only want to talk to me on the phone.
Come on.
You may not even want to be associated with me because you don't think I'm big enough. I understand that, but I still got to put something in you. Come on, somebody. You better shout in the house. Mm-hmm. So some people just coaching them, just mentoring them. And when you understand that, you don't get hurt as often. Am I helping you? Let's move on. It's another thing called the apostolic summons.
Wow.
I've learned something about this. Oh my God, have I learned it. The word is menapempo. It means to be summoned by an apostolic father. Look at Acts chapter 10, verse 5. "And now send men to Joppa and call for one Simeon, whose surname is Peter." Peter was summoned. Look at Numbers chapter 10, verse 4. "And if they blow but one trumpet, then the princes, which are heads of the thousands of Israel, shall gather themselves unto thee." This was a summons. Here's one of the things I've learned. My own apostle has an annual conference. I go most times. And I try to make sure I go when I'm not a speaker. To prove that I'm in this for the real reason. Maybe real transparent with you. I remember when I went through my big failure, I felt this big. And my apostle would take me and send me all across the nation on major stages, restoring my heart and restoring my hope and restoring my vision. Come on, somebody shout. And then I remember one day I saw a flyer. And on that flyer, he sent someone else where he would have normally sent me. And I had a moment I had to wrestle with my heart.
Come on now, God. Oh, God.
And God said, "That man who you're sending now is in the place you were several years ago." I don't know about you, but the devil said to me, "Okay, cut loose now. Ain't nothing else you could get." I don't think I'm going to talk to you like that. Well, I had to wrestle with Joe Prue, I'm not going to do that. And so anapempo means if you're an apostolic son or daughter and your father calls you, you are required to come and bring his children, his grandchildren, which are your children.
Yes.
Just like Joseph did.
Yes.
And set his children at Israel's feet.
Come on, God.
Hello?
Yes.
So you'll find out how apostolic you are.
All right.
And you'll find out how apostolic your sons and daughters are.
All right.
When you summons them.
Come on.
Hello, somebody.
Yes.
Hello, come on, somebody. See, watch this. We have so perverted this apostolic model to the point that when people become apostles, they get the mindset that they have achieved the pinnacle. Hello? But there's a chief of the fathers. There's apostles, and there are chief apostles. Come on, somebody. One of the things I've learned by being covered, I have a network, I've had networks for years. But one of the things I've learned by submission is it keeps me balanced. When I'm around my own apostle, I'll carry his briefcase. When he's talking, I shut up. Because you cannot always be the one that's the alpha dog in the room. If every situation you in, you the alpha dog, you in a dysfunctional situation. You better hear me. And people that don't have light hearts, they avoid places where they're not in charge. You don't talk to me? So when I go and sit with my apostle, it heals me all on the inside. Because I'm not the one right now. You're the man right now. Come on, somebody. And it restructures you. If he calls me, I don't wait 5 days to call him back. I honor. And a pepo means I got summoned. Or I check in.
Yeah, that's good.
When I have sons that don't call me, watch this, I'm not gonna make you mad, but this is a fact. When I got sons that don't call me very often, that's a level of dishonor. I call every week. Why? I'm summoned to do so.
Yes.
I hear in the spirit, call your father.
Jesus.
For no other reason to say this humbling statement, I'm checking in.
That's good teaching.
That's good teaching.
I'm checking in.
Wow.
Yeah, my own network is growing. I just came from Africa, but guess what? I'm checking in. Come on, somebody.
Yes.
I was just in another city and saw people get out of a wheelchair, but guess what? I'm checking in. How you doing? Apostolic summons. Are you getting something?
Yes.
I'm running through this quickly.
Oh God, it's a blessing.
Apostolic supply. Listen to this.
Wow.
Pro-pempo. That means when you have one assignment, Romans 15:24. Whensoever I take my journey into Spain, I will come to you, for I trust to see you in my journey and to be brought on my way thitherward by you, if first I be somewhat filled with your company. The term to be brought on, by the way, the Greek word is pro-pempo, which means I expect you to buy my ticket. Oh, you didn't catch that. Others, you say I'm your daddy, right? So guess what? I'll be in Charlotte. I'm only going to buy a ticket to Charlotte. I need to get to Cleveland. You're going to buy my ticket when I get there. Pro-pempo. You are called to help me financially. Oh, come on, this modern day, high-minded culture we live in. Come on, somebody. They would say you're pimping them and everything else. Come on, somebody. But the word there, that's an apostolic metric. That part of your assignment is to supply the apostolic. By command.
Hallelujah.
All right. Or I'm going to make my apostolic call annual visit to your house, buy my ticket this day. Now, you know, we've got to be reasonable.
Uh-huh.
I don't need a first class seat, but I'm coming in this day. Would you get my ticket?
Uh-huh.
Get me a hotel. Doesn't have to be the best, just decent.
Uh-huh.
Help me along the way.
Yes.
I'm going to Africa. I need you to send money. Not please, but you possibly, maybe, could you, if you can find out, if God talked to you. No, propendo me, send me some money. This is a metric. See, watch this. As apostles, we think we're only supposed to be on the receiving end.
Yes, sir.
Wow. I'm a man under authority.
Yes.
So apostolic supply means that those who are part, and you will find out, yes, you will, who are the apostolic sons and daughters. They come to money.
Yes. Come on now.
Right.
There have been times me and my wife have sent a tithe. It was like I didn't want to look at the check. But I knew I had to do it.
Come on now.
Because I can't ask for what I'm not giving.
Mm-hmm. Right. Yes, God. Yes, God. Yes, God. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Yes, God. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, God.
Pro Pampo.
Yes, God. Yes, God.
Yes, God. Titus 3:13. Paul writes and says, bring Zenas the lawyer and Apollos on their journey diligently, that nothing be wanting to them. So Paul calls them up and says, do this now. I got a couple of apostolic sons. These churches ain't, their networks ain't doing too good. I need you to pay for the tickets and send them over here to me.
Mm.
Oh,
man,
come on.
Come on, God.
Prior to this teaching, you would say, I quit that network. He just using me. But there's a metron of the apostolic where you are called to supply.
Come on. Mm-hmm. Come on, God.
That's right.
Are you listening to me?
Yes.
You are called to supply. 1 Corinthians 16:10. Now Timotheus come to you, see that he may be with you without fear. Or words, when my son Timothy comes, I'm writing a letter. Make sure he don't have to worry about nothing.
Wow.
Oh God. This is stuff we do not want to do today, do we?
No.
You want the apostolic or the real apostolic? Which one do you want? Let no man therefore despise him. What's he saying? Do not let my son Timothy be despised, because you didn't take care of him.
Jesus.
Don't let him have to go to Traveler's Aid to get a ticket. Don't talk about him and say, well, if he was a man of God and all that stuff, he would have the money. He ain't, no, I don't want to hear that, Paul said. Paul said, you pay his way.
That's right.
And don't put him on Greyhound. But conduct him forth in peace. In other words, don't even get mad about the fact you haven't paid his way. That he may come unto me. You know, I learned something. Years ago, in my early days in ministry, I was so anxious to preach. If somebody invited me someplace, I'd drive to the end of the world to get there.
Yep,
I'd be so tired when I get there. I'm doing that today. Now, I'm proud.
Right.
But if you think I should come,
that's right.
You pay for me.
That's right.
I'm not going to ride the Greyhound.
I know that's right.
Because I'm 63.
All
right. So around the Greyhound, I ain't going to be no good to you. And don't put me in no hotel where I can't sleep because people are running up and down the halls all night. Hello, somebody. I ain't going to be no good to you. So, I thought you were humble. Yes, I am humble. Or save your money up and call me when you got some money saved.
I know that's right.
Am I talking to somebody?
Yes.
Stay with me now. Moving on. After you move from temporary to permanent. Hello. How do you move from the temporary apostolic license to a full measure without committing the sin of trespass?
Wow.
The Bible said you have to have a just balance in meat, weight, and in measure. That means there's a legal measure that you take that you don't have authority to take. Mm-hmm. I have seen people start apostolic networks based on administrative skill.
Wow.
They're good organizers.
Wow.
Watch this. Organization is not order.
Wow.
It is an aspect of order.
Yeah.
But it in itself is not order.
That's good.
And we are attracted to what is organized, which we should be. But organization is not divine order. It is an aspect of order. And so that's why we have these networks that Jesus described. He would bundle them all together. That meant by good branding, good marketing. The Bible says they shall surely gather together, but not by me. They've come together based on a theme. Based on a common thing that they don't like. Hello, somebody. Or a common enemy. You know, you have some people leave the church and the person who led them out only got one message. How much they don't like you.
Oh, right.
And 6 months they ain't got nothing else to preach.
Wow.
But there's a place from the temporary license to the permanent license. I remember this story. Let me tell you this. This happened to me about 35 years ago, 40 years. Maybe I was a teenager, maybe 35 years ago. And we started a coffee house at Open Door Baptist Church. I had no idea what I was doing. I just did it. And got a bunch of Baptist kids saved. Some dead people today who have been ministry. Pat Bloom came through that.
Yeah.
Some pastors in the city came through that little coffee house that God sent me to birth, not knowing nothing.
Right.
I did it for about 6 months, and all of a sudden these two ladies came from somewhere. I don't know, I was only about 19. Two ladies came from somewhere, and all of a sudden, the grace to run that coffee house shifted on. I couldn't understand. I'm a young man. And years later, God showed me something. Because I finally, even though the grace shifted on them, for a season I fought that. Because I started this. And finally I yielded to it. And God saw me do something else.
Yeah.
But years later, God said to me, "Don't you understand? I trained you back then.
Wow.
I gave you a temporary apostolic license all the way back then." Somebody shout it out. And then years later, he told me, start a network and call it Justice Fellowship International. Because my heart has always been to see the poor taken care of. And to see signs and wonders. So he said, make your thing justice with signs following. So what did I say? What I'm pointing out to you. He gave me the temporary license when I was about 19 years old.
Yeah.
Now sometime I threw the license away. Stepped on the license, sin against the license. Somebody talked to me in the house. Tried to go premature with the license. But then in about 1980, something he said to me, start Justice Fellowship. I had no idea how to start an apostolic network. I had no idea how none of it worked. He just told me, start. Now back then, I didn't know anything about the apostolic. So I'm driving down the street one day, and God said, I'm going to make you a bishop. I said, oh, no. I don't want to be no bishop. Because in my mind, everything about a bishop was something I was not interested in. And God said to me, I'm going to make you a spiritual bishop. I said, watch this. He told me I had a small building on 93rd. He said, put Bishop Prue on the building. I said, what? So when the sign man came, I said, put Bishop Prue. Somebody came to me and said, you know, they're going to laugh at you when you put that on there. Because you got this one church. So I didn't know nothing there. But I put it on there, and lo and behold, a lady called me up and said, they laughing at you. I was working for Ohio Business Machines then. I'm driving in my car one day. When the lady told me, I was mad at God. I said, why are you telling me to do that? It's like I told them to be laughing at me. I drive up to Wendy's, that's pre-cell phone days. And I pull up to that thing, you know, when you go up, put your hand out and die. Mm-hmm. And two people walk up to me, two pastors. As soon as they walk up to me, I knew what they were, they could get the word out of their mouth. They said, we want you to cover us. This is the same day. Come on, somebody.
Wow. Wow.
Oh, my God.
Wow, wow, wow.
I didn't know how to cover them. I didn't know what to tell them. I didn't know what to do.
So
I go to the church. I only have about five people. I go to the church. They show me their finances. I'm going, yeah, I'm sure I'm going through the most. Yes. That's good. That's right. Had no idea. But watch this. God was taking the temporary license. Somebody shout.
Wow.
Even though I didn't understand it. Hello. And now I'm licensing you fully. And within 6 months I had 8 churches I was covering, which I did not know where they came from. Not one of the people I ever had any relationship with before in my life.
Wow.
All right.
Start hearing what's that?
Yes.
So there is a time when the temporary becomes permanent.
Jesus.
But you have to understand there are metrics. All apostles don't have the same grace. Not all called to do the same thing.
Yes, yes.
And you have to understand the measure that you're under for the moment.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
If you're here, you're here because God got you here. You're here because there's some measure of apostolic grace on you. Now, I'm not telling you to run out and start something. I hope I gave you clarity to understand. You may be only under a temporary license. You may be an accompanying apostle sent to support and undergird and financially supply that apostolic headship that's over you. But if you're faithful,
amen.
Come on, somebody.
Amen.
If you're faithful, God one day is going to take your temporary license and make it permanent.
Amen.
Amen. Am I talking to somebody?
Yes.
Now?
Yes.
Put your hands up and give him some praise.
Hallelujah.
Come on, praise him.
Hallelujah.